Now, you might be saying to yourself, why the person at the front of the stage who's looks like the Greek version of George Clooney, don't laugh, I do look like George Clooney, got up here to get you to hug each other. And the reason why I did that is because I dared to be different. All of you in this room dare to be different, whether it's in your business, whether it's in your community, or whether it's in your family, or whether it's in anything that you're involved in. You all are standing up to do something that is different. The Australian Lebanese Chamber of Commerce dares to be different. And tonight is one of those examples of an event which it pursues to continue the growth and to support the businesses in the Australian economy. And it is great to see so many of you here this evening to support the Australian Lebanese Chamber. Tonight's reception is being held in the beautiful venue of Dalton House. Paul Signorelli, who's here with his team, will provide us with the best meal, beverage and service that you could ever receive. If you all want to know, Paul Signorelli has been in the kitchen from this morning to make sure that we have the best food here this evening. And I can tell you, Paul also told me that if you want to utilise the wonderful facilities here or down at Piermont, he's offering only tonight only a 10% discount. So you'll see, I don't know where Paul is in the room, I did hug him. Oh, there he is, he's on table 13. Now Paul has said, only tonight only, if you want to use any of his facilities, it's 10% discount. And it's not the Greek Lebanese 10% discount, it's the Italian 10% discount. All right, so that there, thank you Paul. For those who don't know who I am, it's strange to have someone of Greek background up here on the stage at a Lebanese Chamber of Commerce. But the reason why I'm here is because I am the director of the Business Leaders Council, the Australian Chamber of Commerce and Industry. And I'm very proud to say that the Australian Lebanese Chamber of Commerce is a proud member of the Australian Chamber. So it's great that we can combine our resources, our stewardship and our leadership to work together for the betterment of all businesses here in Australia. Today I acknowledge the traditional owners of the land on which we meet today, the Gadigal people of the Eora Nation. I'd also like to pay our respects to elders past and present. Friends, the Australian Lebanese Chamber of Commerce strengthens trade relations between Australia, Lebanon, the Middle East. Over 33 years, they've been supporting local businesses, expanding their operations both nationally and internationally. The Chamber of Commerce creates opportunities for members and their guests, for opportunities to network, to expose their businesses to the wider and general community. The Chamber is here for its members and they endeavour to grow not only here in Australia but also overseas. The Chamber's key objectives are to aid and promote bilateral trade opportunities between Australia, Lebanon and Middle East, to exchange cultural and business practices between Australia, Lebanon, and in the Middle East, and to encourage education and training for its members. And finally, to facilitate opportunities for members to network and expand their careers or business, hence why we're all here this evening. An example of the work that the Chamber does is that recently there's been a huge delegation from Sudan who came to Australia. In conjunction with DFAT and Austrade and the Australian Chamber, they were able to help the delegation and engage here in Australia. And the work that Michael Risk and the board have been doing in that space is fantastic. Michael is also with Joe Qatar, is going to Beirut for the Tourism Australian Forum, which is going to be held in the next few weeks. Tonight's event has been proudly sponsored by the Arab Bank Australia. Do we have a representative from the Arab Bank here with us? Oh, we have it here. Oh, there you go. Thank you. They have told me, Joe Riss, the CEO, couldn't be here tonight, but I'm told that they are offering a special rate, a special interest rate for loans tonight. They've been told by the Reserve Bank Governor to give out money. And they're here to do a deal tonight. So they're all on table 14. I don't know the people, but they all look fantastic. The two ladies on the table look give it the best look for the table. All the blokes are all there on the table, but they are keen to do business. So can I thank the Arab Bank for supporting tonight's dinner and also encourage you all to engage with the bank that are here today. Also on the screen, you'll see all these supporters of the Chamber. So if you are one of those supporters and you're here tonight, thank you very much for your support. If you want to do business, please support the sponsors of the Chamber, because it is best that we look at supporting each other, and that's why it's important to do so. Can I take this opportunity to acknowledge some of our guests that are here with us this evening? Firstly, please put your hands together and welcome the President of the Australian Lebanese Chamber, Joe Qatar AM. Now, Joe and his board work tirelessly to provide the benefits and the opportunity and the stewardship of this fantastic chamber, and they give up their time tirelessly to ensure that the chamber is one of Australia's leading successful chambers. And it's great that Joe and the board are here this evening to continue the hard work that they are also providing. Can I also take this opportunity to acknowledge Councillor Andrew Ferguson. Councillor, where are you, Councillor? Stand up, there he is. Yep. Now, Councillor is on Canada Bay Council. He's also the Managing Director of Coverforce, but in reality, if you need to talk to him about building applications, develop applications, you can't, okay? But he can help you guide your way through Canada Bay Council. So, and he's also very keen to do business with you tonight. But if you do need any advice in relation to engaging with Canada Bay Council, then feel free to speak to Andrew. Can I also take this opportunity to acknowledge three hardworking media personalities in the Australian Lebanese community? First one is Anwar Hab AM from Anaha Lebanese Arabic newspaper. Yes, put your hands together, because it's these three newspapers that work tirelessly to educate, to communicate to the Australian Lebanese community. Camille Shalala, who's here from the Middle Eastern Times as well, so we welcome and acknowledge Camille. And finally, Joe Khoury from Al Masdar Bill, another publication in the Australian Lebanese community. So please put your hands together and acknowledge the presence of Joe Qatar, the board, and Councillor Andrew Ferguson, and the three newspaper proprietors. Tonight is a special night. We have a panel discussion, and the panel discussion is made up of a number of important and well-regarded speakers in the development space. And the topic for tonight's subject is called City Making and the Rules. And Shame Geha, the founding managing director of EG Property Group, will dig deep in the three following speakers. He's going to get up on stage and he's going to dig in and find out what makes these people tick. The three people that are going to be joining him on the stage is Rick Graf, who's the development director, managing director of Billbergia Group, Danny Arraj, the managing partner of Blackstone Waterhouse Lawyers, and the CEO of Knight Frank Australia, Stephen Ellis. So please put your hands together and acknowledge the presence of our panel. Ladies and gentlemen, the toilets. If you need to go to the boys' room or the girls' room, you go out these doors and go to your left or to your right and go past the lifts that you came up with, and then turn to your right and you'll find the boys' and the girls' room. Emergency services, if anything happens and it is emergency in the building, you follow the staff's instructions, okay, and one of them will probably wear a yellow hat and one will wear a red hat, and then they will direct you out of the building. And finally, when we have the panel discussion, just put your mobile phones on silent so we don't have any disruptions and disturbances, so that we can have a fantastic discussion in relation to the topic that we're having tonight. So ladies and gentlemen, friends, please enjoy the hospitality of tonight's fantastic food and beverages, and we look forward to seeing you in about half an hour's time, where I'll introduce the panel and we'll have the panel discussion. So please, friends, enjoy the evening. Thank you very much. Now, friends, we're going to have the panel discussion, and as I said to you, the title is City Making the Rules. And I'm going to call up each of the speakers and I'm going to quickly read their bio so you know who they are. Firstly, I'm going to call on the facilitator for tonight's evening, and that's Shane Geha from EG. Shane is one of the leading rezoning experts in New South Wales. As the founding managing director of EG Property, Shane bears overall responsibility of all its projects. Shane has extensive rezoning experience and brings a combination of practical know-how and value creation skills to projects he is involved in. Shane has worked on projects and increased the land value after rezoning land at Little Bay, Riverston, Tempe, Wanderland, New South Wales, to name a few. His focus is working closely with clients on property uplift strategies and implementation. Shane has completed his PhD, and he was telling us on the table that he has got 5,000 pages in his PhD in planning, quantifying the rezoning effect at the University of New South Wales in 2013. He is a course coordinator and lecturer at the University of New South Wales, as well as a part-time lecturer at the University of Sydney in a number of engineering courses. Shane has recently been appointed adjunct professor at the School of Civil Engineering at the University of New South Wales. Please welcome Shane Geha. To join Shane, we have Rick Graf, and he's Billbergia Group, and Rick is the global property expert, having delivered major public and private projects in the USA, Hong Kong, Singapore, and throughout Australia over the past 45 years, earning numerous international awards. He was responsible for the development and delivery of Sydney's Belong Bridge, which has become the topical value capture case study in privately funded public infrastructure. For the past decade, he has helped shape Billbergia major developments at Rhodes, Wentworth Point in Sydney, and its 100-level Brisbane Sky Tower project. Rick is a member of the EDIA Planning Committee, Urban Development Committee, and the Housing Affordability Task Force. Please put your hands together and welcome Rick Graf. Joining Shane and Rick is Danny Arraj, who is the Managing Director and Managing Partner of Blackstone Waterhouse Lawyers. Danny leads the Blackstone Waterhouse Lawyers Environment Planning and Development Team. He's known for being practical, commercially focused, as well as his ability to steer a project from concept to planning completion. He's a specialist that advocates in the Land and Environment Court and associated jurisdictions, and is currently advising in relation to a number of major projects. Danny's a leading Australian planning lawyer and has written and lectured extensively on getting the development through council, including publishing a text on this topic. He has previously been a lecturer in the local government law and examiner in the administrative law at the University of Technology, Sydney. In 2018-2019, Danny was recognised in the 2018-29 Asia Pacific Legal 500 as a current finalist in the Lawyers Weekly Partner of the Year in Environment and Planning category. Danny is a member of both UDIA Land Development and Planning Environment Committee, and is married to an Italian. Please put your hands together and welcome Danny Arraj. Finally, to join this illustrious crowd, another illustrious and well-known individual who's leading light in the commercial, residential and space is Stephen Ellis, the Chief Executive Officer of Knight Frank Australia. Stephen's experience spans more than three decades in the property industry across general consultancy work, investment advice, valuations, marketing activities. Throughout his career, he has led a wide variety of teams, from small groups of professionals to leading national property company with up to 1,600 employees, through market fluctuations and transitioning property market, including during times of major disruption. At leading independent global property consultancy Knight Frank, which has over 1,200 employees across 24 offices in Australia and New Zealand, Stephen's key focus is building the business, client relationship management, and positioning the firm as the place of the best property professionals. With his leadership and focus on nurturing culture over the past 7 years since joining the firm in October 2010, Stephen has re-established the business as one of the top agencies in the country, attracting over 650 new people and growing the business significantly in both revenue and profitability. Please welcome Stephen Ellis. Friends, I now hand you over to Stephen Geha to conduct the Q&A and the panel discussion. Stephen.
Well, perhaps the easiest way to start is by reflecting on an event we've all just witnessed, the federal election. And the federal election was unusual, I think, this time around, for one specific reason. And that is we had two very different policies and two very different directions from the two parties. We had one party that talked about new taxation and new government spending through the collection of that taxation. And we had a party that talked about lowering tax in order to stimulate the economy in almost a reverse methodology. Now, to those of you who've studied economics or land economics, you'd know that both of those systems do have support amongst the academics and the practitioners. So today I thought I might open with you, Rick, and say you've witnessed the federal election, an unusual election, and the Liberal Party won against the odds.
And I think the shares in the polling companies are at a record low as a result. and that was really a result of changing technology and changing markets of how to survey today's community versus yesterday's community. And the best thing to come out of the election is that we now have some certainty going forward, particularly from the property industry's point of view. The last 6 months has been quite uncertain times. In fact, it's been uncertain times for a little longer, thanks to the banks and thanks to some of the state government policies. But from a federal point of view, there is now clarity, and I think that will start to bring about an improvement in the market over time. It's not going to be switching the lights back on overnight, but over time.
The sentiment of the market perhaps has changed, would you say, Stephen?
Absolutely. You know, the interesting thing is I came into the office today and one of my employees came up to me and said, you know, thank God I bought just before the election because sentiment has changed. You can feel it. And look, the market, you know, is controlled to a large degree by sentiment. Yes, the banks have been heavy on lending and that's been probably one of the reasons the market's, you know, fallen the way it has. But sentiment is a major driver behind the market and what happens in the market.
I mean, in one of the issues in the election, gentlemen, was about population and immigration and growth. And we really haven't had a mature debate about this in Australia yet, I feel. We are a country of 25 million people. In fact, the 25th million person was a migrant. Did you know that? The 25th million person was a migrant. Yes, like us. And here we are, we've got two political parties in an active election campaign talking about reducing the immigration numbers from 180,000 to 160 or 150, a race to the bottom. Is this something we can debate further?
Dan? You know, Shay, this is a topic I know you love to talk about. Seen you in TV, I know what you're saying. But quite frankly, I think that it was Kevin who came out, Kevin Rudd came out and said, you know, we've got to be 50 million and he got poo-pooed for it. But quite frankly, he's right. And I think we all know he's right. But no one's bold enough to come forward and say that's what the direction, because they know it's unpopular with some.
I mean, if we're talking statistics and we're talking cities, Sydney's now 5 million people. We've also just reached 5 million. You know, I was in China recently, Rick. I know you've been many times, I think both of you have. And when you say we're five, they think Sydney is this amazing place, right? They say, oh, Sydney. Because Sydney, of course, is a very prominent city in the world today. The problem is they say, so how many people in Sydney? And I puff my chest, 5 million. Mm-hmm. And they're just, it's so deflationary, this conversation, 5 million. They've got 100 cities of 5 million. So, can we really be an international global city? Can we be an international global city with just 5 million?
I think we're already fighting above our weight. It's difficult for Australia when viewed from China, where the entire population of Australia would fit into Shanghai.
The entire population of Australia fits into three separate cities in China. So we are the size of Guangzhou, we're the size of Beijing, and we're the size of Shanghai. So there's three Australias.
But But Sydney, as a global city, we do have a higher economic output than most cities our size, and that's a good thing. But Australia's population must grow. You can't have this amount of territory with only six cities around the perimeter and vacant in the middle, when we're next door neighbours with a country with an inversely proportional landmass and population to our own in Indonesia, where you've got 240 million people and a scarcity of land. So we don't want to keep the cork in that bottle for too long, because over the next 50 to 100 years, if we don't manage our population growth and our immigration, then it will happen by means other than peaceful means. So, you know, we've really got to take a long view of our history, and we've built up very slowly over the last 200 years. But the world population is growing much more rapidly than that.
And as Shakespeare once said, what is the city but the people? Just think of it that way. There is no city. The city is us. So we have to remember us. Let me give you a more interesting quote, this one by a more contemporary person. This gentleman is someone well known to most of you. Franklin Delano Roosevelt commented on real estate once, would you believe? This is what he said. I like this. He said, real estate cannot be lost or stolen, nor can it be carried away. Purchased with common sense, Stephen, with common sense. Paid for in full, Rick, and managed with reasonable care, it is about the safest investment in the world. Would you agree with the president?
Well, it's the one... land is the one thing that the world is not making more of. And if the global warming analysis is correct and sea level is rising, that over time there'll be less real estate on the planet than there currently is. But no, it's a secure investment. It's the one thing we can't make much more of.
And Danny,
well, you definitely look at the supply. You know, you're definitely looking at on the premise that land is rare. So that introduces really the supply factors. We've looked at, you know, population being an impact on demand. But what about the housing supply?
The housing supply is essentially constrained by the zoning system and by the regulation, the red tape. You know about red tape?
A little bit.
Who knows here about red tape?
Of course, the uncertainty attached with it all. We know all too well that we have uncertainty in our costs when a developer goes to purchase land. It does not know what the levies will be.
I mean, it wouldn't surprise many of you, perhaps, but let me give you the statistic. You know, on an $800,000 unit today in Sydney, one-third of that cost, $240,000 of that cost, is fees and charges. Just think about it. Is there any product that you consume right now in your daily lives where a third of the cost of the product is fees? Maybe petrol. Yeah, maybe petrol.
Well those figures
cigarettes.
Or cigarettes, that's 300%.
Those figures are taken. We're the highest state in the country with those figures.
And you know red tape? You know the history of red tape, Danny? Red tape was originally invented as a concept by Holy Emperor Charles V and King of Spain in the 16th century. And he invented it because he wrapped the files that were important to the emperor with red tape. That was meant to speed the file up because the ordinary files were wrapped with string. So the emperor wrapped the important files with red tape. Can you tell me what happens to a file wrapped in red tape today? That's five centuries later.
Well, I'll tell you what happens in the planning environment.
Uh-huh.
I'll tell you what happens when you lodge a development application and you're asked to for a deviation of the development standards. And there's a circular in Planning New South Wales saying, well, you can't exceed the development standards more than 10% on the one hand. And I mean, I know that from my own experience with the firm that we've reached exceedances of more than 65% with development standards, despite that circular, what that circular states. So the uncertainty in terms of whether or not, you know, clause 4.6 applies or not is something that, you know, in your words, red tape, we're governed by, where we also have decisions from the courts, our commissioners, are exercising discretion in different ways. So on the one hand, you know, we have things such as, it's all too common, unauthorised building works.
But could I say, we are horrified, I think, as a population, if my observation's accurate, by the unregulated city. We're horrified. The unregulated city, Rick. So we've made rules. That's a good thing, right, Stephen? That's a good thing.
Basically, yes, we need to have rules, certain rules.
Certain rules. And where do you think we're at in terms of the rules? Is it at the right level?
No, I mean, if people talk about the cost of housing, cost of accommodation in Sydney, and you quite rightly talk about the cost of getting approvals and the cost of building. I mean, if we could speed those things through, you know, one of the things which really frustrates me is that we, in Sydney, we go and get these wonderful, renowned global architects design these buildings, and then the planning department come in and they completely bastardise them. And I think that, you know, we should, Sydney's architecture is some of the most boring in the world. I mean, the matrix is filmed.
I agree.
The matrix is filmed in Sydney for one reason, is because it's the most indistinguishable city that they could find. And
Canberra comes close.
I mean, Sydney has to be, I've been to 300 cities around the world, perhaps more. I would say Sydney would have to be the most beautiful natural setting of a harbour of any city I've seen. It beats San Francisco Harbour, it beats Vancouver. It would have to be. We really live in a blessed place.
Yep.
We really live in a blessed place. I mean, to wake up every morning and see Coogee Beach, to come to work every day and see the harbour. I mean, you know, the cheapest things in life are free, right? The view, that's free. Well, maybe not from the floor that I sit on.
Also air apparently, not fresh, but air is generally for free.
Fairly clean. And free, yes. So the rules, of this city are what's slowing things down, right? I mean, really, a city this beautiful should have how many people in it?
Well, Rick? It's not always only the rules. Our approval process, which is governed by the rules, are far too slow. Any DA greater than 20 mil... it's taking on average 278 days to determine.
That's quick.
Yeah, that's quick.
That's quick. I reckon longer.
And that's when your DA has been accepted. Sometimes simply getting a DA across the counter is difficult. But that assumes you haven't had to go through a rezoning process beforehand, for which you'd add another year. But Shane, maybe a good way of comparing our performance as a city or as a state in determining major development applications is to compare, say, Sydney and Brisbane. And as Billbergia Group, we've been doing major projects in both, and take a building that might have 1,000 apartments in it. In Brisbane, in the middle of the CBD, we're doing Brisbane Sky Tower. We're just at the top now. And that's 10 levels down and 90 levels up, so 100 levels. It's as high as the aviation limits will permit. So, you know, the aviation ceiling is 274.3 metres. We're at 274.3 metres. But the application for that is a $1 billion project going through Brisbane City Council.
How many councils do they have in Brisbane?
They have one.
Okay.
They used to have 21.
Okay.
But they have one.
So they went from 21 to one.
Yep.
We went from 43 to about 38.
Yes. Yeah. Very Brilliant. Successful amalgamation in Sydney. Yes. But with Brisbane, the DA for that project took 5 months and came out with a fairly clean approval. Mm-hmm. So 5 months for a $1 billion project, as high as the aviation limits will permit, 100 levels, in the middle of the CBD. In Sydney, by comparison, well, first of all, it would never happen. But if it did happen, it would be after 5 years of struggle.
It'd be a horror story.
Well, on Barangaroo, 8 years.
8 years for Barangaroo, and if you read the Herald... If you'd read that communist newspaper called The Herald, hopefully no one here from The Herald. Yes. I'm sorry. What surprised me once is they talked about the journalistic integrity of The Herald. I thought it was a joke. The Herald rubbished Barangaroo so much, particularly the open space that was done at Barangaroo, which I think is magnificent, by the way. I just don't understand how you could spend so much effort, and they brought the gentleman who'd done the refurbishment on Central Park in New York to design it, and they had this great committee, but every single day, if you'd opened the Herald, you would have thought we're actually creating a monstrosity.
Well, it's an abomination insofar as it's underdeveloped.
Thank you. It's underdeveloped. But you know what? I work in the city pretty much most weekends, much to my wife's chagrin. But I leave sometimes the office in the mid-afternoon at a very nice part of the city, and it's empty. It's an embarrassment. There's nobody there. I mean, what would you tell an international visitor who's come to be impressed? You would say, this is our city at 3 o'clock on a Saturday afternoon. There's no one around.
Well, they should just be with... Well, the lawyers are all working, that's why.
At your end of town?
Well, yeah, we're all working.
Inside, but nobody's outside drinking.
That's why the restaurants are empty. All the lawyers are in the office for once.
I mean, if we could create the perfect system, Stephen, what would that system look like in your view?
Oh, well, from a planning perspective?
From any perspective. From a Stephen Ellis dictator.
First of all, I wouldn't have as many planning authorities in the city for a start. You've got to have one centralised system, which everybody understands, centralised set of rules, which everybody understands, so they don't vary from one part of the city to another part of the city. And try and standardise things and give freedom to people to create, be imaginative with what they want to do within general parameters.
But it's kind of hard to have rules and then need people to follow the rules and then ask them to be imaginative. Isn't that right?
Yeah, but our rules are flexible enough.
Right.
But the criticism is if you depoliticise the decision-making process, you start hoping for that red tape to eradicate the red tape. And of course, maybe some decisions will be made on a proper basis. But what has happened with, you know, the JRPP and IHAP is it hasn't really depoliticised the process.
Not at all. The appointments are all essentially political. And not just that, I think I was joking with my staff the other day that if we do two more panels, the minister can go permanently on holidays. He has no more function. How good is that? So the reason why we elect a person who's transparent in public office is they could be the final pillar, the final decision maker in the most important industry in New South Wales, in my view, right? Well, and meanwhile, we've panelised it all. So panel one, panel two, panel one tells us how to breathe, panel two tells us where to build, panel three tells us X. Two more panels and the minister can go to Alaska for a while. Rick?
Well, our biggest difficulty facing housing supply in New South Wales is the rigours of the system. The banks are a close second because even if you can get an approval, you can't necessarily get buyers who can borrow, and developers who've made the sales still may have difficulty borrowing from the banks to get their construction loans. But we are a growing population. We have children being born at a greater rate. We have a burst of fertility through the cohort.
Excuse me, everyone. We require a burst of fertility. So please, tonight when you go home, I would like to ask for your humble assistance.
and older folk are living longer. So we've got more births, fewer deaths, and we've got immigration. So we've got three factors pushing the growth of population in Sydney. Now, we are one of the most attractive cities on earth.
Right.
There's no
doubt about it.
There's no doubt that people want to come here. But we're not producing housing at the appropriate rate. We, you know, for a decade, we were producing 13,000 housing completions a year.
Right.
The last 2 years, very good results. We've been getting almost 40,000 a year.
But that's the number that we need every year through to 2036 just to hold our own with the projected population growth.
But Rick, how do you expect, you know, your $800,000 example, Shane,
yeah.
That takes us, I'm just trying to do the maths here. You've got GST, stamp duty, land tax.
Yes.
Contributions.
VPA, Section 94.
You're almost a third of that 800, and then you're taking.
And growing.
So how can you justify any development with land values being greater than $30,000 a unit site?
Oh, almost. If the market demands there, you simply add it to the price. That's what we've been doing for 30 years.
Well, and then we complain that our housing is not affordable.
And then it becomes unaffordable.
Well,
so
yes.
I've got a very simple idea for the government. If you take off all the taxes, we can give you an $800,000 unit at the same profit for $540,000. Yeah. How's that for an idea?
Why don't they put a cap on 94 contributions for 5 years?
Look, at the end of the day, it comes down simple economics, it's supply and demand. What worries me is talking to both senior people, Westpac and at NAB,
mm-hmm.
Their development book for apartments falls off a cliff in 2 years' time. Now, if we continue to grow, as we inevitably will, where's the supply going to come from? Now, I posed this question to the governor of the Reserve Bank before Christmas. When he was talking about the next movement in interest rates being up.
Mm-hmm.
And I said, you have no idea what's happening out there. You know, we're going to be having a situation where there will be no stock in 3 years' time to meet the demand, or limited stock to meet the demand, and yet it's going to put pressure on house prices. And the response I got was, well, that's just the cycle.
Well, the levers that the state government has to increase or decrease the rate of housing supply in Sydney are limited, but they're available.
Right.
And they measure their success or otherwise by the number of approvals
right.
and the number of completions.
Yeah.
And for the last couple of years, they've been tracking higher because there's been a huge effort to get them there. But what no one tracks, no one in government or in the industry, is commencements.
Right.
But anecdotally, I can tell you, if there are developers in the room, you know as I know, that for the last 6 months there's been virtually no commencements
right.
of major projects. Now, the figures for 2017-18, three quarters of the housing completions were apartments, one quarter was house and land. So the old days about it's all about house and land doesn't apply anymore. Three quarters are in major projects and units. And they are not being funded. They are not being commenced. Sure, this crane's still swinging and there's completions being achieved, so supply is happening. But as Stephen just said, the banks know and we know that it's all falling off a cliff. As these buildings that are under construction come to an end, there's no more work for those workers, there's no more housing for the housing supply. And unless we change the system dramatically and do a resuscitation package over the next 18 months, we're going to see housing supply at record low levels again in 2021-22.
Yes. What makes things worse, you also have talk of value capturing.
Yes.
New contributions of value capturing.
And the affordable housing levy and the fees march on. It reminds me very much of what Mark Twain once said when he was very ill towards the end of his life. And they said, how are you feeling? He said, I'm dying with the help of too many physicians. And this is what I feel. Every time we need something done, the government has a solution. We'll make another rule. Another rule. Another rule. And I think we're dying with the help of the rules. All well-intentioned, mind you. The government does like us, don't they, Stephen? The government's solution to the problem is usually worse than the problem. That's what Milton Friedman once said, and I agree with him. But now the 5% deposit is coming in. The government's going to fund the remainder of the 15%.
To approved applicants.
Yeah. Mm. Aha.
And the metrics for the approved applicants haven't yet been determined. So it's the old story of an election promise made in haste. That perhaps may not have been through cabinet or through the machinery. By the time the rules attached to that 5% come through, it may not be as easy to get as one might think.
I feel very optimistic about the next 3 years or 5 years or 10 years. But I always feel very optimistic about the next 3 years, 5 years. Do you feel optimistic about the next 5 years, Danny?
No. I don't share your optimism, only because I don't see that if we're talking about the market of residential mixed-use development, that market is definitely hasn't reached rock bottom, despite what I think you believe.
Yeah. Everybody's entitled to their opinion.
Yeah, I know. I think that there's plenty to go, and I think that for the next couple of years, this will go for a few more years, where unless supply is impacted, you know, if of course everyone in this room stopped building tomorrow, maybe that would resolve the problem in a year's time.
How?
But, you know, one of the things I'd say is if you're looking for a house on the Lower North Shore, you go and look on
the Lower North Shore. People live there, right? Yes, they do.
Yeah. You cross that bridge, things happen for a house. You see how many houses are for sale? Probably less than 10. Hmm. And that's because people say, I'm not going to sell. If I'm going to sell, I've got to buy something, but there's nothing I can buy. So it's a never-ending spiral. So people are saying, well, I'm not going to drop the price to meet the market. So unless I can find something equally as good to buy at that price, which has been dropped by the similar sort of amount. Having said all that, you know, we generalize, and whether the market's gone down 10%, 11%, whatever, that's to generalize. Our research tells us that the top end of the market's actually gone up.
Hmm.
So actually, if you're looking to buy an expensive home, you're paying more for it, 3% more for it this year than you did last year.
Mm-hmm.
So it's not constant right across the playing fields. I think the apartments have been hit harder than the housing market.
Right.
I think the western suburbs have been hit harder than the eastern suburbs and Lower North Shore.
Right.
It's not a level playing field.
Right. Rick?
But our housing supply is facing a crisis over the next 24 months. And I don't use the word crisis capriciously. It is a serious exercise. Those of you in the business, you have your employees in the construction industry, in the property industry, but over the next 2 years, as contracts come to completion, there will not be replacement contracts to employ all the people who are currently in the industry. The skill loss is a serious risk, because remobilizing the industry when the market swings back is not as easy as it sounds. But we can sit in our corner and throw rocks at the government in their corner, but that's really not a constructive exercise.
No.
What we have to do is try to convince the government of the benefits of collaboration. Private sector and public sector need to get on the same ledger. They need to get to a point where there's a common understanding of the issues faced by the industry and of housing supply, and what we do together to solve the problem that we're facing. Unless we do that, we won't keep the housing supply running over the next decade as it should to accommodate the growing population. The demand is still there, but it's not going to be satisfied over the next few years.
And what about if we brought a lot more people? Let's say we were to change the immigration policy, right? We know they'll all go to the seven places.
How about we change government policy or the consent authority capping contributions? Projects will still remain to some extent profitable if you put a cap on contributions.
Well, you can cap contributions.
We've got the highest infrastructure charges than any other state in Australia.
Yes.
Something needs to be done at that level.
See, at the end, someone's got to pay for it, right? So it's either the consumer or the taxpayer. There's no such thing as the government, you realise. The government's just a transparent medium of highly paid bureaucrats who basically just recycle the money from us back to us. So at some point, who pays?
So is it user pays? Is it the fees and charges that we pay get recirculated back to us? And who pays for that 50% of the federal budget that goes to social security and pensions? Where does it go?
Well, in this city, there's been a constant cry for the last 5 years about housing being unaffordable. And the measures that have been taken by government to make it more affordable include adding special infrastructure charges for a block of land or a unit of about an average of $20,000 to $25,000 per lot, and uncapping Section 94 contributions, 7-Eleven contributions, that's rising to $25,000.
Okay.
Affordable housing levy, which will run to about $50,000 a lot, so you're at about $100,000 additional cost on top of the average unit price.
So that sounds like a good way to improve affordability.
So we keep deluding ourselves that we can make things more affordable by making them more expensive.
Yes.
And that's just not going to wash. And in the long run, we're going to continue to complain that Sydney's housing prices are higher than anywhere else in the world. We're still number three globally for housing prices.
Gentlemen, it's fantastic to have you with me today. And could I finish with a quote from Charles Dickens, who said, "These were the best of times, these were the worst of times." But if I could finish in my own words, "These were the best of times." Take care.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Can I now call on Joe Cotard to give the vote of thanks, but also to give a small gift to each of the speakers. Nadia, sorry, I think we've got some small gifts to give, but please put your hands together and welcome Joe Cotard, the President of the Chamber, to say a few words. Okay, all right, okay, you said thank you very much. he's going to give the presents to each of the chaps. We just wait. Nadia's going out to. Well, while we're waiting, Joe, how big is the organisation?
With the chamber of organisation, well, you measure it by the quality of the people. Not so much the numbers, but if you want to specifically ask for the numbers of the people, there's about 4,000 involved on a daily basis with the Chamber of the Commerce through their sponsorship, through their people connected to these particular sponsors. So there's on a regular basis, there would be about 4,000 people getting benefit out of the Chamber's Chamber of Commerce, with all the activity, with all the information, and all the function they do along the year.
Well, that's fantastic, isn't that great, Joe? Thank you very much. Now, Nadia's here. We've got a small gift to give to each of the speakers. So the first one goes to Shane.
You called the bottle of wine. It's a small gift.
Small gift. Thank you. Just get a photo.
Thank you, Shane. Thank you for the informative panel and for the wise and quality question about how we're heading in relation to develop Sydney and Australia on a wide basis. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you very much.
And Rick.
Thank you, Joe. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Joe.
And Danny and Steve. Can we just get a photo with the panel?
Thank you, Paul.
Oh, absolutely.
Thank you for your dedication, and thank you for your support to the Chamber and all the wonderful things you do with that New South Wales Chamber of Commerce. Thank you.
Thank you, Joe. Thank you. Can we just get a photo? Now, that concludes the formalities for this evening. There is a whole range of desserts over there on the right hand of the room. I'm told to remind you all that the next Australian-Lebanese Chamber of Commerce annual business luncheon is on the 25th of July 2019. So please put that in your diary so that you can make sure that you attend the next Australian-Lebanese Chamber of Commerce lunch. Now, can I thank you very much for allowing me to be your Master of Ceremonies for this evening. I hope you thoroughly enjoyed it. Please stay around. The food and coffee and sweets are here for you to devour. And I hope you all have a lovely evening, a lovely Friday, happy Friday, and a great weekend. And we look forward to seeing you at the next Australian-Lebanese Chamber of Commerce luncheon. Thank you very much.